Whatever.
Hola, la gente de Sci-Fi World. Hopefully that meant hello, people of Sci-Fi World. Mi nombre es Guillermo. I'm Bill Watterson, the director of Dave Made a Maze. I don't know how to say that in Spanish.
Got it.
Yeah.
Okay, I got to see your movie in Vif two months ago. Really nice. And it's
gotten better since then. I'll tell you, I fixed a couple things.
Oh, you're kidding.
I didn't go full George Lucas, but I did.
What kind of things?
They were mostly sound design.
Uh-huh.
I made the Minotaur much more present,
uh-huh.
Especially when he's off screen, so uh-huh. that threat is always there. And then the thing that bothered me the most, to the point where I actually get sick to my stomach if I think uh-huh. about it too much, there's one scene in the giant piano room.
Yes.
Where you see the character's face, and then the point of view shot goes all the way down the hall of the giant piano. It was a digital mat, but it really bothered me that, you know, in a world that had to be handmade in order for the film to be true to itself.
Mm-hmm.
It was a movie about an artist, so everything had to be handmade by artists. It bothered me that we had a digital shot in there. So we built a miniature set and shot it. And about the size between you and me. I'll show you a picture later.
Okay,
please. And we shot that and placed that in there so that when they look down the hall, it's an actual practical set.
This movie, it will be released sooner or later in home video and DVD.
Yeah, it's had its release in the States.
It will be extra of how is the after and the before of that scene.
Hmm. No. There's subtle enough changes that, and I never want to see the digital mat again. And they did an amazing job, but I never want to see it again.
Just show me the photo.
Yeah, yeah. It's nice. It's we cut these tiny strips of duct tape and put them down on these tiny pieces of cardboard. It's very satisfying.
The main thing is that we need to know that this movie is entire new world mm-hmm. inside of the living room of a regular American artist.
Yes.
So please try to explain the obvious, how this is born, how this
yeah.
began, please.
Yeah, where the idea for the script came from or actual
the whole
yeah.
How you could sell this idea.
Yeah, well, I don't know that we could have, which is why we just made it ourselves. But the screenwriter was working on a movie, writing a movie called Operation Death Maze, I think. He has these wonderful, he belongs here, and he's a wonderful genre mind. And it reminded me of this time when I had built a fort in my bedroom. And my mother came home calling for me. I was at a friend's house for dinner. She came home calling for me, didn't hear me, opened the door to my bedroom and saw this maze, this fort, and freaked out. My mother's Italian. She freaked out, ripped the apart looking for me, thinking I was lost. It was that good a fort. But she was, in her head, I had gotten lost in my own bedroom. And that idea, that concept is so wonderful. It's so rich with opportunity that he took the Operation Death Maze script and changed it to be about this guy who builds a fort and gets lost inside. And then it was just being in love with that idea of, if we said it's true, he says it's bigger on the inside, no one believes him, and then you go in, oh, he's right, it is bigger. That's such a, it's a big ask of the audience, it's a very, very big suspension of disbelief moment. But for someone who grew up loving Tom Baker on Doctor Who, and he would open a phone box and there would be a spaceship, and you're like, great. If you believe that, you'll believe this,
Bigger is inside and the outside.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's not a child's play. Take care, no?
Right, mm-hmm. Yeah. And then just that idea that things spiral out of control. Something simple and even potentially innocent or playful or fun can really spiral out of control. That happens a lot. It happened with making this movie. We had this fun idea. We'll get some friends together. And 6 years later, after raising all the funds and attaching all the talent and hiring the crew and finding the space and building, just like, oh my God, it just got bigger and bigger and bigger. And we often felt like we were trapped in our own, something of our own design. We did it to ourselves, but it was like, oh, this is so much more than we ever thought it would be, but you can't, once you're in it, you're in it.
Trapped in your own movie.
Yeah.
Because it's a whole universe inside.
Yeah.
It has to be a challenge to be your first It's a film.
It was big. It was big. And if I'd known how big, there's a chance I might not have done it. So that's good that I didn't. That I didn't know that. I mean, I'm not a young man, and I'd been on sets for 15 years in many different capacities as an actor, as a crew member, or production assistant. So I knew the world of set, and I had enough friends that were very talented people that would either work on this or bring in people who were of a similar caliber of talent. So I knew we could do it, but honestly, it was, I distinctly remember that first day, it was bigger than I thought it would be. We got better people, better sets. We saw that first shot on the monitor, and sort of in my heart, I thought, this is a real movie. We were just going to try to make something, but here we are, and this is day one, and this is a real movie.
So before the little changes that you mentioned before, mm-hmm. you can say that the whole thing, how many percent of the film is totally handmade?
100. The only, there's one green screen shot. Mm-hmm. Obviously the stop motion was mm-hmm. comped in. But that's still a practical effect, handmade. The only green screen shot that we used was the moment when the characters turn black and white. Oh. And we only used that. What we comped in was a live practical set that we built. So that was kind of the only digital trickery. I mean, there were other things we did with speed ramps and playing things in reverse and, you know, split screens
tricks,
and things like that.
But not digital.
Tricks, exactly. Exactly. Okay, but yeah, every set that's in there was built by hand in 20 days.
20 days.
That we shot for 20 days.
That's going to be the next question. How many time do you
have? We shot for 20 days. We had about a month of pre-production mm-hmm. in a separate space, but we didn't have enough room to store sets. So we had the apartment built.
You're missing my questions, because my how big are you supposed to be these sets?
Yeah, the apartment we built, and that on the first day that we moved into the warehouse, we put up the apartment, and that was 2/3 to 3/4 of the space in the warehouse. Mm-hmm. So the rest of the warehouse was storage of gear mm-hmm. and, you know, director's chairs and monitors and things. So we could only have one set up at a time, the apartment. And we shot the beginning and end of the film in the first week, because it all takes place in the apartment. Then we started covering the apartment walls with cardboard, and from the rest of the movie, we were building as we went. So we could have two sets up. We could have like a hallway and a big room. Like we have the origami room and a narrow hallway. So we would shoot in the hallway while building the origami room. And then when we were finished in the hallway, we would go shoot in the origami room, and they would redress the hallway, and we would just switched back and forth.
This means that there is just one unit, no?
Yes, one unit, and we also, in order to achieve the shot at the climax of the film, not to give it all away, but where everything's collapsing, we destroyed every set at the end of the day on camera.
Okay.
So we never had, there was one day where we had 2 days on the set, I think, but other than that, everything got destroyed as soon as we were done filming the scene. So there was no going back. There was no reshoots. Yeah, nothing like that. At the end of the 20 days, another film was coming in, so we had to be completely cleared out. So some of the sets were only standing for 3-4 hours. But I will say this, and it's again, it sort of goes back to something we were talking about. We had a rough cut of all the principal photography, and we thought, you know what? What else? We can do more. And that's when we came up with the idea for the puppet scene, where they turn into... So that was done months, 6-7 months after we shot the movie. We knew we couldn't get all the actors back, but they had they had to do what we call ADR. They had to go in and record some additional dialogue and stuff. So we had them do these lines that we gave to the puppets, and we shot the puppet scene 7 months after principal photography.
Don't you keep for yourself a little piece of cardboard for fans? You know, this kind of... cost $1 million in 10 days in eBay.
Yeah, it was, I wish there was more. I have some of the puppets in my apartment. One of the walls, two of the walls, there's an underwater wall and a planetarium wall that we used at the end as they're cutting towards the center. Mm-hmm. We cut quickly to all these other walls to make you feel like, well, there's these other rooms we could have visited. The maze is even bigger than we thought. I took some of the nice details off those, some of the planets and the fish and things like that, and I put them all in a box, and I feel like maybe we'll send those out with DVDs or give them away at some screening or something like that. I mean, I don't know who wants what, but I could, there's only so much I was willing to part with, you know. And we have something stored. We have the Minotaur head. We have the origami head. Mm-hmm. We have the giant origami birds. We have Dave's hand. We have the top of the present, the pink present that he takes off and goes down. Some small pipes that look amazing. All the corrugation and everything. They look really beautiful close up. Bryn's face, when she turns to paper, we have her face. But, you know, there was no time for sentimentality. We either got turned into something else, or we had to be out. We had one day and just five of us to take the whole thing down and throw it out.
How many hours did it take for
each day? The bulk of the crew was probably there 16 hours. The actors were only there 8 hours. We only went into overtime once or twice for half an hour here, half an hour there. We didn't keep the actors there long, which I was really proud of, having been an actor on an uncomfortable, physically challenging, claustrophobic set. I just didn't want them to, I didn't want to burn them out, but we burned everyone else out.
You almost pissed again one of my questions. Burn the world board, because for sure you will be very graceful that it's not the old times with the old lights, with the, all the heat of those lights, because it will be everything burnt. Kind of very heat lights. It's one of the advantages of the new era of shooting. I mean.
Yes. Yeah. The only day where it was a blast furnace on set was the perspective room, mm-hmm. where there's all these sort of in-camera optical illusions, because in order to have the depth of field, sorry, this is too technical. Mm-hmm. In order to have the depth of field to pull that off, you have to have a lot of light so the camera can catch everything all the way in the back of the room mm-hmm. to everything, because the chair is, you know, the chair was right here, it's, you know, 30 feet back. So we had to have an immense amount of light on set that day. And it was very sweaty.
Very sweaty.
Very, very sweaty.
But no dangerous with the cardboard.
No. Yeah. We made sure the lights were clear at all times, because they get very hot, and we're working in a paper world. Mm-hmm. The biggest danger was just underfoot, because everyone was building everything. There's stuff everywhere, and everyone was working with knives and hot glue. Yeah. So there was a lot of hot glue burns. This, I don't even like saying this, but the very last day of set, the producer lifted up a pile of cardboard, because we were just, all right, we're done, clear it out. And if this was a box cutter,
okay.
He lifted it up. Oh. It was like that. It was like with the blade way up. It was like right there. And he stopped. It was the last day of shooting. We had very nearly had a very, very dangerous accident, but it was, I don't know what I believe in terms of higher powers, but the amount of luck, the amount of the confluence of talent and just things that went our way. This is a small moment, but I walked onto the set for, there's the room where the bed of spikes swings and kills the bass player from OK Go. And I wasn't sure what that room was going to look like. We knew we had pillars and where they would be, but in terms of the aesthetic, and we'd have sconces that for the camera to light. But the art department just went with triangles sort of as a theme. And Tim Nordwin from OK Go walked on set and his shirt had triangles all over it. It was this great choice by the costume department. And Stephanie Allen walked on set and she wore her own earrings. She wore these beautiful little triangle earrings. And no one had communicated together. You know, everyone was just doing, the shirt was right for the character, the earrings are beautiful for Stephanie, the triangles were right for the room. I mean, they're spikes, so you kind of already are thinking along those. But for all of those things to happen without any of us communicating or pushing for it. Yeah, it took care of itself in a way that made you feel like it's gonna be okay. It's gonna, there's something else at work here beyond just what we can physically do with our hands. There's some magic here.
So for sure you are really proud.
Extremely, extremely. I can watch it and see flaws, mm-hmm. of course. It's my first film, it's not gonna be perfect. No film I'm ever going to make is going to be perfect, but, you know.
You must notice, and you must know that even in your 10th film,
right.
You will find
issues. Of course. Of course.
Some things to change.
Yeah, I look forward to it.
Okay.
I look forward to it. And but to be here, I mean, I went for a swim in the ocean this morning and then got to share this film with a crowd. How could I be anything but proud? I never thought. We just wanted to make something, kind of similar to the guy, I just wanted to make something. That was us. We just wanted to make something and say, there, look, we did it. To be here was never in my mind.
This
never would have occurred to me.
My next question is, how is it going? How is going to film in festivals and releases?
I mean, I'm in the eye of the storm, but to me, it's far, far exceeded expectations. Even the fact that, you know, you guys walked up and was like, oh, I saw it at Motel X, oh, I saw it at NIF, oh, I saw it. It's like, wow, how did we end up in all these different countries and all these different places? We made such a personal film, such a small, strange film. There was no thought that it would live internationally the way it has. You know, Korea, Brazil, places I'd never been, I never would have imagined my film would have translated. And not just been there, but been sold out or well attended or, you know, meant something to people. And the festivals that I've gotten to attend in person, to get to talk to audiences afterwards and see that they were touched emotionally, that it meant something to them. Not just that they had fun or it was original or creative, which are incredible compliments, but that it meant something to them emotionally, personally too. Oh, who could ever ask more? If I had that happen to 10 people, I would be proud. But 10 countries? 20 countries? So beyond anything I could have imagined. I mean, I actually get choked up thinking about it.
To the next one, you know?
I was telling my brother, you can get fatigued. I mean, I directed this film in 2015, mm-hmm. in May of 2015. It took us that long to finish post-production and get the money to do stop motion and the music and everything. It just took forever. And you can get fatigued with one film, one project. But as soon as you arrive at a festival, you're just like, I want to make the next one because I want to come back. I want to come back with something else and see what do you think of this? You like that? What do you think of this? You know.
And once you are out there talking with colleagues, filmmakers, mm-hmm. there is a lot of stories coming in, coming out. It's no end.
I've started running into friends from other festivals, and I want to see them again. Mm-hmm. And how am I going to see them again? I'm going to by making another one. You know. It seems like another impossible mountain to climb, but being here and seeing an audience reaction is all the inspiration I need. It's all the gas in the tank, the fuel that I need to go back and push the rock up the hill again, because I want to come back with something new, something different, something better, something bigger.
Two last questions.
Please.
I always like to ask these questions as an actor, a director, try to choose one part of the film that you're really most proud of for when the audience, the people who is looking this window or reading this interview, says, this is the part that the director says to me that is the part where he most like,
yeah.
Where I'm more proud of.
The thing that's the most fun to me and the day that I enjoyed the most was probably the puppet scene. Mm-hmm. I'm a lifelong fan of Henson and the Muppets, and to get to be working with talented puppeteers and making that happen, that was so fun. But the thing that I'm actually the most proud of is it can be a very divisive moment in the film. It's a very indirect, bordering on pretentious moment in the film, but it's when Dave and Annie tunnel to the center of the maze and they are transported back to their kitchen. And they have to sort of fight through this cycling, looping mm-hmm. conversation moment until they get it right. It's very art house, but that day on set, I knew every frame, I knew every cut, I knew every... I was never more prepared, never more sure of what I was doing and why. You know, as they get more intimate, then the shots get more... When they start, they never share the frame because they're not sharing anything emotionally. When the cuts are with all the costumes and that, just that whole idea of with the costumes of... I don't like to over-explain it, because it's meant to be indirect. It is a very strange moment. And I like hearing what other people think. People's reactions to it. I like hearing their interpretations more than explaining what I was doing. But I was so fully in the driver's seat for every shot. And the way it came together, and the kinds of reactions, the kinds of emotional reactions people have had, what that moment has meant to them, even if it's not what I was intending. That's not that my next movie is going to be all weird stuff like that, but but that's the moment that, to me, I feel very, very proud of.
Very nice. And now the last one is talking about the next work that for sure will came. Imagine. You have all the money mm-hmm. that you need, all the time that you want. Which be that story that you want to tell? If you want everything in your hands, that kind of movie that you say, one day, no matter what, I will do this.
Yeah. There's never enough time and never enough money, but... There, a couple things come to mind. There's a children's book, a Dutch children's book, that I really want to bring to life. I don't want to say what because I don't want someone else to rush out and get ahead of me.
A classic.
An old one, yeah, okay. One that I grew up with, but no one else I know in America grew up with, which just kind of makes it a bit of an opportunity.
It's never made.
Right, right. But it's very, very fantastical. There's witches and stuff like that.
Okay.
And that would not be cheap, because there are a lot of monsters, and I would want to do them all practically. But honestly, my next the film I want to make the most right now is my next film. Mm-hmm. It's the one that I've written now, that's in people's hands, that I'm starting to get feedback on. It's about a musician. It's got a monster. It's got a big kung fu battle in it, and I just really want to make it. I want to make it so badly. Even with limitations of time and money, I still. And it's not going to be the cheapest movie to make, but I want to make it.
That it will be the next one, no?
I am.
Perhaps 4 years from now?
Well, it's in the hands of people who could get it. We could go into pre-production shortly. It's you know, this is my first film. So this is my first experience of the industry beyond just these little jobs here and there that I would get as an actor or whatever. So,
but,
you know, I don't want to... I don't even know what I'm getting into, but...
you know, this is a very good film. It will be opening a lot of doors for you.
Mm. I think so.
Undeserved one.
Well, thank you. Mm-hmm. And secretly, I would like to make a movie about Dagobah.
Dagobah?
Yeah. If they ever need, you know, if they ever want to tell Yoda's origin story with a ton of puppets in like a Dark Crystal style, building the whole world, I'm the guy. I'll spend that money. I'll spend it wisely.
Sell yourself, because I want to see that.
So do I. That's why I want to make it, because I want to see it.
There is no director choose for that movie yet.
I, if they're making one, I don't know anything about it. But
do what you want.
I want to see it, so let me make it so I can see it.
He's talking about the Yoda film, man. Okay, great. This was fighting.
Wonderful.
One more.
Okay. Please.
The film is mostly about procrastination. Mm-hmm. Getting things done, but getting involved in it for too much time.
Yeah.
Have you felt that way about the film? What was your inspiration? As an artist?
As an artist, 100%. I used to be in rock bands all my 20s. I have all these albums that never got released. You know, we cut all the tracks, and then the band fell apart. Or we were mixing the album, and we had everything set, and someone quit. And, you know, I just have all these ideas that never, you know... Having an idea is meaningless. Having done something is very meaningful. Not meaningless, that's swinging the pendulum too far. But, you know, it's not good enough to just have an idea. Everybody's got ideas. What have you done? You know, that's what matters. What have you accomplished? And we've accomplished something amazing here that I the whole time we were making it, it was like, when are we ever going to make this movie? We've 5 years of raising funds, you know, so it felt like it was going to be another, it felt like it was going to be a victim of another victim of the same process of, we've got this great idea, but, you know, and just getting over that hump, you know, even when we were editing and that line where Harry says, you never have to fail if you never finish anything, it's like, ugh. Shut up, because it was year 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and it still wasn't finished, and I'm still tweaking it, and like, no, this is more of this, more of this. You know, it was definitely starting to feel like my own movie was talking to me in a way that I was not enjoying. You know, and then this next movie that I was just talking about, yeah, I wrote the script, great. Who cares? I want to make it. You know, okay, I wrote a script, great, big deal. Let's make it. You know, it's not good enough to just write it. It's gotta, I want to be here with it again, talking with you guys, you know, next year or the year after.
I can't wait to tell you a story as that. A few years ago, here in Sitges, in one top table, we are talking with a very young director, new director, he was presented a film. That film won here the award for best special effects.
Ooh.
That guy, with his next film, about after that was Godzilla. And the next one was World War. So right. You are in the same road.
Okay, do or do not. There right. is no try.
Right, exactly. Exactly. That's the same.
It was exactly like that. A very nice conversation. It was an interview. It was talking about films, about what do you want, what I want. That kind of conversation. So it's.
I do want to do a kaiju movie, by the
totally
way.
I'm totally convinced that
big time.
To good people always have to happen good things. And you deserve it, man. Okay? Very nice. Okay, please.